You are listening to the audio production of The War on Children, Providing Refuge for Your Children in a Hostile World by John MacArthur. Published by John MacArthur Publishing Group, this book is read by the author. Preface. Most adults can remember the halcyon days when society sought to protect children from harm. Not anymore. Popular culture has turned on the young with an unimaginable barrage of destructive assaults. It is an aggressive campaign being executed with unconscionable malice. The primary goal is to brainwash children through the spread of lies shamelessly intended to obliterate biblical spirituality and morality, and thereby systematically dismantle the foundations of society. Secular social engineers profane politicians, entertainment moguls, and many business leaders are all in on this sinister strategy. They are determined to raise and totally reshape the culture. In order to accomplish that goal, they must capture the minds and hearts of the next generation. Assaults against children are coming from all directions. Propaganda is embedded in children's entertainment, in advertising that targets young people, in the music they listen to, and even in their school curriculum. Media produced for children today is practically all infused with ideas that are purposely designed to undermine the biblical values that helped shape Western culture for their ancestors. If you doubt that, visit any secular bookstore and look at what is being promoted for children to read. The idea is to indoctrinate future generations with a belief system where good and evil are fundamentally inverted, where gender is not binary, but rather a sliding scale with infinite possibilities, where sexual perversions are celebrated and where God is banished from public discourse. Christian parents face an especially hard uphill battle to raise their children in the discipline and instruction of the Lord, Ephesians 6:4. Practically every bureaucrat who works in a government agency or public school system is convinced that government knows better than parents how children should be raised and what they should be taught. Furthermore, public schools nowadays are overwhelmingly and often militantly anti-Christian. And the government wants even more control over how, when, and what our children are taught. In 2021, President Biden proposed a spending bill with a price tag of $3.5 trillion. Nearly half his proposals had to be cut if the bill had any hope of getting through Congress. But one feature that survived all the cuts, the one major expenditure that proponents of the spending bill boasted about, was a package providing universal preschool and affordable child care at a cost of $400 billion. One of the frightening implications of this development is that the federal government is now positioned to have the dominant voice in shaping curriculum and educational philosophy for children starting at age 3 and continuing through their college years. It is probably fair to say that in this era where so-called progressive policies dominate public policy, most government officials are now convinced it is their right, if not their own duty, to decide how and what children are taught. In a 2023 ceremony honoring the nation's public school teacher of the year, President Biden said, quote, "There's no such thing as someone else's child. Our nation's children are all our children," close quote. He was echoing a theme liberal politicians have been drumming into the American consciousness for decades. In her 1996 book, It Takes a Village, Hillary Clinton famously challenged the God-given parental role. She drew her book's title from an oft-quoted African proverb, "It takes a village to raise a child." There is, of course, a germ of truth in the proverb. Kids cannot be properly raised in total isolation, and what they are exposed to in their environment will influence the development of their character. Parents need to make sure they are surrounded with good influences. But Mrs. Clinton's critics and supporters alike understood that her objective in writing the book was to make a not-so-subtle argument against parental rights. She believes the secular state knows better than parents what is in the best interest of today's children. She is therefore convinced that child-rearing should be a collective enterprise with the government ultimately in charge. The insinuation that children somehow belong to the government stirred lots of controversy and concern when Mrs. Clinton's book first debuted, but in the decades since, it has gained widespread popularity and overwhelming support among politicians and legislators. In 2022, Vice President Kamala Harris, speaking to a group of mental health care professionals, expressed the sentiment this way, quote, "We all believe that when we talk about the children of the community, they are children of the community," close quote. It's not easy to dismiss that remark as a clumsy, off-the-cuff verbal fumble, as if it were merely one of Mrs. Harris's trademark giddy tautologies. Slogans and catchphrases like those might even sound perfectly innocuous if our politicians were merely affirming society's duty to guard the innocence of children and keep them safely out of harm's way in matters of moral purity and physical health. But President Biden, Mrs. Harris, and Mrs. Clinton are clearly trying to make the case that the government has an overriding interest in, and therefore ought to have supreme authority over, the moral indoctrination of children. Indeed, the political party to which all three of these politicians belong has not only advocated, but worse, already enacted legislation specifically designed to diminish or eliminate parents' rights, while granting government agencies increasing authority to decide what values children will be taught. Such high-handed policies are rooted in the belief that parents, especially the religious or conservative ones, are simply incapable of raising their children properly. The conclusion is that it is therefore the prerogative of the government to determine how and what children should be taught. That notion has become standard policy in public schools, local libraries, the entertainment industry, government agencies, and many large corporations. That's the reason society is now inundated with a flood of people and programs aggressively seeking to indoctrinate young children with values that reflect a radical, secular, and sexually deviant worldview. It explains the push for bizarre new activities targeting children, like graphically explicit sex education for preschoolers, drag queen story time, and ubiquitous efforts to involve children in gay pride celebrations. This is why even the Walt Disney Company has made a concerted effort to insert LGBTQ+ characters into all their children's programming. Those trends are not likely to be reversed in the near future. Governments do not easily relinquish control once they have seized it. Public schools and government interference in the parenting process will get worse, not better. Christian parents cannot simply float passively along with the drift of our culture. We need to renew our commitment to wise, careful, attentive biblical parenting. If you are a parent, you need to recognize that no matter who you are, your children are not exempt from the ongoing effort to commandeer their worldview and alienate them from biblical principles. Above all, realize that this is war. It is, of course, not literally armed combat, but, as we will see in Chapter 5, it is even more serious than that. It is a dangerous ideological conflict with eternity at stake. The enemy's aim is to capture your children's hearts and put them in permanent bondage by enslaving them to a sinfully corrupt worldview, a godless, amoral belief system. Your responsibility as parents is to keep them free from that bondage. You must do that by taking control of what they are taught. Teach them God's Word. Train them in righteousness. Model righteousness for them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.